Hey there, explorers, it's Brian here with you for another adventure around the world. Look closely at this map of the world. You'll notice I've left off the title and a key. What information do you think this map displays? Go ahead, look for clues. You might notice that China and India have regions that are especially dark. And you might see that much of North Africa, Australia, Russia, and Greenland are very light in color. If you haven't already completed the preview activity, pause the video here and write a prediction about what you think this map is intended to show on the preview page of your PDF. Make sure to cite some evidence from the map to explain your reasoning. Let's zoom in on the US to see if we can figure this out. See the dark purple spots dotting the country? There's one here, another one here, and here. There's a whole darkly shaded region up in the northeast. Conversely, a lot of the west is pretty light in color until you get out toward the coast, where you can see much of California and some areas further north with dark coloration. What do you think the dark areas represent? If you wrote in the preview that this map shows where people live, you're absolutely right. If this map had a title, it would be Global Population Density. The more people that live in a place, the darker the coloration appears on the map. You might even be able to spot a city near you. It's no surprise that China and India stood out to us from the beginning. These two countries are some of the most densely populated and are the world's only two countries with over a billion people. And we noted that North Africa and Australia were sparsely populated. But why? Well, to answer that, we may need to take a look at another map. Join me as we visit some diverse biomes around the world. Ready, explorers? Today's objectives are to identify the five climate regions in the Köppen climate classification system, to discuss their features, and to review the geological factors that cause them to exist. And that brings us to a new map, the Köppen climate map. If you still have the population density map fresh in your mind, or the PDF image in front of you, compare the maps briefly. Pause the video and note some similarities in the two maps on your lesson guide on page 3. Obviously, there are a lot more colors on our new map, and I still haven't given you a key, but if you look at some of our favorite locations, you may see similar shapes. Let's look back at North Africa and the Australian outback. The population density map shows that these regions are sparsely populated, and the climate map shows these regions in bright red. In fact, check out what happens when I show only the red places on the map. We haven't visited these places in the course yet, but using your background knowledge, can you infer a reason that North Africa and the Australian outback aren't home to many people? Record your thoughts in the lesson guide. If you said that these places are extremely dry or that they are deserts, you're off to a great start. A comparison of the two maps will show that to a certain extent, we can predict the population density of an area based on its climate. Is it really that simple? Well, yes, actually it is. The Köppen climate classification system organizes the world into five major climate zones, and the overwhelming majority of the world's nearly 8 billion people lives in the temperate climate region, which is characterized by moderate temperatures and precipitation and is mostly made up of forests and grasslands. Included in the temperate region, also called the mild mid-latitude, is much of China, India, and the United States, the world's three most populous countries, along with much of Western Europe. If human-environment interaction is as big of a part of the human experience as these maps suggest, we should take a look at the climate regions around the world and get to know them. You learned in a previous lesson that latitude is one of the factors that determines climate, so let's start from the equator and work our way toward the poles. You saw this map before when we focused on North Africa. It shows arid or extremely dry regions, the Sahara Desert in Africa, the Middle East, the Australian Outback, and the Mojave Desert in America's Southwest. Arid regions receive scarce amounts of rainfall each year and are mostly deserts and steppes. At similar latitudes are the tropical wet regions, which are blue. This region is warm, if not downright hot, most of the year because it's also close to the equator. Rainforests such as those found in South America, Africa, and Indonesia are a distinguishing feature of the tropics, but they're also home to savannas, or grasslands which are common to sub-Saharan Africa, Brazil, India, and Southeast Asia. For the most part, rainforests aren't very populated, with the exception of Indonesia, the fourth largest country in the world, with over 270 million people living almost exclusively in a jungle climate. But here in Jakarta, they have carved out enough room for over 10 million people. The continental climate region is also called the cold mid-latitude region and features a relatively dry climate with warm summers and cold winters. The land is often marked by forests and taigas filled with millions of trees. The continental climate region includes Eastern Europe, Russia, Canada, and Alaska. The fifth and final climate region is even less friendly to humans. The polar climate region lacks warm summers, has little or no vegetation, and consists of tundra and ice caps. It's flat out cold. Freezing. I mean, sub-zero temperatures. Simply put, if there's anywhere on Earth you don't want to be, this is probably it. The land in the polar climate region includes Antarctica and parts of Russia and Canada located inside the Arctic Circle. Let's refer back to your lesson guide. Of the five climate regions, which do you live in? And which would you like to visit? So what creates these climate regions? Well, we've already covered part of this, so let's do a quick review. You probably remember from a previous lesson that the greenhouse effect is the natural process of the sun's warming of the surface of the Earth. You probably remember too that the rotation of the Earth and its revolution around the sun and the tilt of its axis causes the seasons and makes different parts of the planet warmer than others. The sun's heat is distributed around the globe by convection, wind patterns, and ocean currents, and the warmth from the sun helps create precipitation. All of those contribute to the climate of any given location on Earth. A location's proximity to water is also a big factor. Water heats and cools more slowly than land masses, so coastal regions will stay cooler in the summer and warmer in the winter, creating a lower range of temperature changes. A great example is California, where the entire western border of the state is formed by the Pacific Ocean. But think also about the Mediterranean Sea and its surrounding nations, those such as Italy and Greece. The final important factor in the climate of a location is elevation, or altitude, which you may remember is distance above sea level. As elevation increases, atmospheric pressure will decrease, causing cooler temperatures. That's why it's cooler when you travel to the mountains. Let's investigate what happens at different altitudes in the Himalayan mountain range between South and East Asia. The diagram shows us that at this latitude, lower elevation areas closer to the coasts have dense forests that receive a lot of rain and have warm temperatures. Then, as elevation increases, cooler and cooler temperatures occur until we reach the eternal snows where thrill seekers attempt to scale the roof of the world. Or consider the climatological differences between Denver and Indianapolis. Many people know Denver as the Mile High City, and just over 1,000 miles away is Indianapolis, Indiana. These two cities are at almost the same latitude, but elevation is a different matter. While Denver sits more than 5,000 feet above sea level in the Rocky Mountains, which we can see in the distance, Indianapolis is just about 900 feet above sea level without a mountain in sight. For this reason, Denver is a semi-arid, cool climate with low humidity but lots of sunshine, whereas Indianapolis has a hot, humid continental climate experiencing all four distinct seasons. As we wrap up today's lesson on world climate regions, think about where you live. What features of the land contribute to its climate? And what makes the climate of your hometown unique, even from other places with a similar elevation and latitude? These questions are a few more you can ask to help the world around you come alive. Stay curious, ask questions, and until next time, keep exploring. Hey, hey.